So yeah, my name is Stanislav Vasilyev. I'm from Estonia, as Victor already said. And yeah, hopefully one day we will see each other in Tallinn in on Agile Saturday. So we've been used to make those conferences quarterly, but we made a bit of a pause recently. So currently we are a bit on vacation, but hopefully soon you will have a great chance to visit Tallinn. So my talk today is Anonymous Analyst, and I suspect there might be a couple of analysts in the room. So anyone want to confess? Oh my God. Oh my God. So, you know, I want to return alive from that session. So before you start throwing eggs, tomatoes at me, I will just show you. I will fast forward and show you the last slide, what I have there. So basically, but it's not the end of the session, by the way, so don't worry, you don't have to leave yet. So I do believe that analysts are very useful and that they are it's an essential part of an agile process. It's just some of them are doing the wrong thing. And that's what I will try to explore during my talk. So when I will be talking, and you will have an urge to throw something at me, just think about that slide. And please don't do that. So, also, during my talk, I actually do hate PowerPoint presentations. So in both as PowerPoint, so it wants to show you beautiful pictures. So if you don't like what I'm saying, just introduce you. Hopefully you will like that part at least. So also to be fair, that there are many roles in agile teams that can be anonymous, right? So sometimes they are over specialized. There might be anonymous architects, anonymous project managers. Analysts I have chosen by several reasons, and one of them is that besides talking at conferences, I also do a bit of teaching at university, and I do teach master thesis at the University of Technology students, and I ask them sometimes how many of them did a bit of coding, or how many of them have written a line of code, so, and less than 10% usually. When I ask, who are you going to be when you graduate? So many of them want to become analysts, so, and have the idea that later we will become project managers. So that kind of strange idea of career path, so that is also related to power. So, as I said, I will be mostly showing the pictures, so I have also a couple of diagrams, so, and here is one of them. So, this is how many of us used to make software, and some of us currently do. So, this is a waterfall model, so where every next step happens only after a previous step has finished. So, and let's start with a confession, and probably now the other half of the hall will try to kill me and throw some eggs and tomatoes, but isn't it so that agile community has been hostile, too hostile against waterfall? Did you get that feeling also? So, agile community was blaming waterfall model in all the things, it being evil, slow, you cannot succeed, and etc. But true being said, waterfall sometimes works, right? In some separate conditions and situations. It's just a different price that you pay for that process. And there is a price for any process that you're using. If you're using Scrum or Agile, so anyway, there is something that, that you have to sacrifice for that. And as long as you know what is that, and as long as you are ready to pay that price, it's actually okay to use it. Isn't it? So, but this hostility and Latin physics, energy preservation law causes an interesting reaction. First of all, people become ashamed of using waterfall, right? So they start calling that, for instance, ROOP. So, and they seriously confuse people who actually know what is ROOP, and they know how categorization is working and it's all that using. Secondly, organizations start going away from waterfall just for the sake of going away from waterfall, just to follow the trend. So we some people visit conferences, we hear that, and then they just come back to work, realize that they are protocol, and they start to change for the sake of change. And they change what's actually currently working for them into something that we don't understand. And the most interesting part is that any organization that uses waterfall actually quite rarely, or I would say even never, uses waterfall by the book, because it's simply impossible. So yeah, first we dream, when we design, and then we start implementing, but then during implementation we realize that some things cannot be done, so some requirements are missing. So we go back, so we have a feedback loop, and start reanalyzing, redesigning. So basically it's not waterfall, it's more like water scrum in some way, right? So and that's how it all started. If especially if you have a long project, like two-year project, you cannot simply keep on writing code. You will have anyway a bit of redesigning, retesting, and etc. So, but if this is something virtual, sometimes you don't even see it anywhere defined, or you might see that picture on software development manager's wall in a frame. So that's how we do software. So what we usually do see is organizational structure. So how organization is structured. And basically, all those boxes from a model, they are represented in the organization as a unit or a department, etc. And what we have here is a really hostile environment. Because those different departments, they form silos inside organizations. And they act as a separate companies within one company. So they start talking to each other, and that conversation is really strictly formal. So there are special people who can answer your questions probably on some special days. Sometimes communication happens even by a special protocol or contract. So you sign a contract that's how you will communicate with our department on those days, and etc. So, and more importantly, that generates the culture of delegation and done work. So development will focus on writing the code, not on doing the product, but writing the code. Testing will focus on finding bugs. And God knows, maybe we have also incentive structure and bonus systems, etc., that are related to that. So that people would get more paid for more bugs found or for more code written, but not for the delivery software. So, and development will consider the part of a job done when they hand it over to somebody else. And the more specialized people you have in your organization, the more department you have, the more handovers you have, the more delegation you have in your company. So, also ironically enough, sometimes development and testing are led by different people. So we have different goals, completely different goals, what we want to achieve. So we start blaming each other, development, so that's how developers and testers start hitting each other, right? Developers think that testers are just picky and they just try to find something. Testers think that development doesn't work at all. Project management thinks that those guys are lazy, and when they both fail to agree, they flush it down for maintenance, and that's their fault. And I've been there, it's a really sorry place to be in, because you hate everybody and everybody hates you. So, and analysis basically is not on that picture, right? Sometimes it's part of project management, sometimes it's not, but it's rarely part of development. Sometimes those are separate rebels that don't belong clearly to any of those boxes. So now come to the pictures. So to me, analysis has always been a bit foggy. And as Pasco said in his keynote, well, I think that there are two main problems with analysis. So first of all, first one, as Vasco said, is prediction. Right? So we try to predict the future. So because when we talk about the product, we talk about the idea, we talk about fantasy, we try to imagine how that product would work in the situation that we imagine. And that's just a lot of assuming, isn't it? We base one as we assume something on another, and then we base on that something else, etc. So there is a famous quote from US Patent Office Commissioner that everything that has been invented is already invented, and it's been 1899. So before cars, internet, Twitter, Facebook, computers. So, and for that guy to predict that there will be computers and Facebook, which probably quite a big part of our lives, he would have to predict also the use of it, that people in 100 years would share their statuses in the net. So how crazy can it be? So second problem with analysis is that we try to design the software before we're actually doing it. So there were really wonderful tools that would allow you to auto-generate some code when you just draw some diagrams and then generate it for you. So and when programmers just fill in the gaps, just write some a bit of a logic there. So nothing really complicated. Everybody can do that. So we try to design the software, we try to design database models, and basically not everybody is understanding what is how to design a software, how to design a great software. And that also causes a lot of problems. But my biggest beef against analysis is that they cannot fail. Just think about it. Just think about it. You think of an idea, you write it down on a paper, and it's genuinely correct, because that's what the customer really wanted. He wanted it after that. You don't have yet any feedback about the real use of a product. So whatever you put in your analysis, you are right. And if you have a separate department on the box which has a different incentive and bonus structure, so you are doomed for bonuses. So there is no way you can miss that. So for instance, let's take on that picture, right? Customer would want to have one ice cube on an hour. And there are just a million ways to do that. So when your analysis would probably state something like put one on another. And if you will want some more details, like we will start considering shadows, lighting, angles, and things like that, at some point we will just run out of ice. So, and what we need, and that's the whole Agile community is about. Well, swamped, by the way. But collaborative environment. So whole Agile is not about TDD, continuous integration, it's not about Git. It's about forcing people to work together and have shorter feedback loops. We don't want to have a lot of delegation, we don't want to have a feeling of a finished work. We want people to work together in a feature teams, not a product teams even. And think about the product as a delivered software, not as a product as handed over to somebody else. And if you think about it, software development is a journey. So we go down the path through the swamp, that is a swamp, and we learn more about it. So analysis is an essential part of the software development project. It just doesn't stop before you start doing something. It continues. And That is what it should be all about. But we need to have somebody in a team that will be able to help us understand the knowledge, to crack the domains, to talk more to the customer, find broken examples of how things can work with each other. And down the line, we can adjust and see what is behind that corner. So I will try to give some hints and steps what I think analysts, and not only analysts, can do. And it actually doesn't really matter what kind of development system, development process you do have. Is it a waterfall, is it Scrum, or is it Kanban? It doesn't matter, as long as it works for you. It can be applied. Because for me, analysts are like researchers. They help us see things. Sometimes things are upside down. Sometimes they are not. As I said, I'm doing a bit of teaching at university, and just doing the research is not enough. You have to publish it, and you have to get the feedback from the community. So analysts are not about analyzing. Analysts are about sharing the knowledge. So understanding that and making it accessible and available to everybody else in the team. And good analysts differs from a bad analyst is on how good you can share that and how good you can make it available and accessible to everybody else in the team. And because of course, self-organizing and cross-functional team would probably take care of that problem themselves. But isn't it good when we have, especially in a big project, when we have somebody who has dedicated time for that and would be able to help us? To help us to study more. So analysis is not about analyzing, it's about sharing the information, sharing the knowledge with everybody else. Secondly, you know that great reaction. But UML stands for undefined modeling language. Well, there have been so many revisions and so many versions of what UML is, so everybody actually lost. And some people cannot even figure out what is that and how to draw that. And no one can actually draw correct UML diagram after that. So drawing a diagram like that will take a lot of time. It's probably like a week's work. But then you can endlessly discuss it on meetings and refine it. It's just the best time killer ever. You can go to a meeting and say that, oh, actually that method is not here, it's there, so let's move it. So, oh, actually that method is here, not there, let's move it back, and etc. So, but that doesn't make our software, our product any better. We just sit in a meeting and discuss some after things. And when people start developing that, they will probably do something different. So that's why at least I was drawing UML diagrams after the project, if I had to, for some reasons. So what we have to do is, instead of writing software structure and software design, we should have a common language that you would understand with each other. And that's what I think also analysts can help us with. And there is actually a great book that's Blue Book, Eric Evans, Domain Driven Design. So he speaks about how to make sure that all your stakeholders in your product speak the same dictionary. So for instance, you say customer logs into the site, so and you immediately know what customer is it, registered customer, is it new customer, is it back office operator, is it not back office operator, and which site. And what does exactly does he do? And also you would have your stories, user stories, also containing the same objects. And then if you would show something way, way simpler than that, with relationships of those main objects in your system, the business people can actually say, yeah, that makes sense. Those things are related. Or no, those things are not related. They cannot be together. And another great way how to do that was actually proposed by that guy. And he has written that book, Specification for Example, and Koi Project. So he talks exactly about that, how to organize workshops, how to make sure that everybody in the team has same vision about a product, about a domain, and how to make it accessible and available to everybody else. So he also talks about examples, and those examples are the best way to explain requirements. So let's stop discussing some weird and complicated logic, how that system works and in which behavior. So if you do that, then you do that. If you're a new customer, when you go another way, etc., you will just get lost. So instead of that, make an example, concrete example from your system behavior, and use that as a communication basis. And if you will put that in front of everybody, probably a tester would say that, okay, that example makes sense, but what if we change it a bit? What if we replace that with that? What will happen then? And then we have a new base and a new great topic to discuss and refine what we actually have to do. And do we have to do it at all? Do we understand it correctly? So analysts can help us test things by creating more test scenarios, test data, test scenarios. And if we can make it automatic, if we can automate them, that would be even better. Because when we can make that knowledge accessible also to our customer, that he would see that, okay, those scenarios, that's how we validate our system by those examples. So they would help us create more scenarios, more done definitions of how the system should behave. So next one, probably it's more like a general wish, and I think it's applicable to like any company. Some people have been suggesting that the whole company that we should get rid of emails. So no emails at all allowed in the organization. Because email is a great way of delegation. It is. You write an email, you send it, and you think, okay, my job is done. I'm done. I did all I could today. I go home. I send an email. So people who receive that email, they see a long list of people who also received that email. And what do you think?
Thinks that the other guy will do it.
Yeah, the other guy will read it and explain it to me, so no one reads it. So that's why emails are evil. Of course, sometimes we have to use them. But it's like, it would be probably a great idea to get rid of all emails at all. But we shouldn't use them as a mean to share the knowledge, because that's a great way to get into a delegation trap. We just delegate, we think that our job is done now. Somebody else will pick it up, and somebody definitely or probably won't. And then things get lost, and then things get weird. So it's easier to take the steps down, forget about the view, just go down and talk to the people, do the mind, make it way faster. Because how people understand the written text is way different from the way how you will explain it. They can provide you with immediately the feedback. So, and probably the last one, be part of a team. So that definitely a product owner, right? He has a better suit. Star developer. So yeah, sometimes it's probably wet, muddy, and really uncomfortable. But you are together, and you can share your happiness, your sorrows also together, and you share your information on a much way faster rate than you can imagine. Actually, in that delegational picture with organizations, if you just sit all together, you will have half of the arrows gone. Because when you are sitting together, you share your knowledge, you're all on the same page. You don't have to have any specialized wiki documents that would describe something what everybody knows anyway, already, right now. So, because basically, when people discuss, you immediately are a part of a discussion. If you found out something new, you immediately share it with everybody else. And that information, that knowledge is already accessible to everybody else in the team. So, in short, analysts help product owners to work with a backlog, with examples, and to see what's, they provide the customer perspective, especially if analysts, or sometimes people call them business analysts, especially when people have been working in that field for a long time before, for instance, in banking or taxes. So there is a lot of knowledge, and if someone's been working there for quite a long time, he can think like a customer. So analysts help the QA with many examples how we can test it with most scenarios of our system usage. And analysts help with Scrum Master to help with elements, but especially if they are related to complicated customers which you have to pursue, etc. And please don't change for the sake of change. Have an idea what do you want to achieve and then start from there. And that's all for me. So here you can find my email, blog. Actually, this talk is published as a blog entry. You can find me also on Twitter, and please do connect with me on LinkedIn. And I do hope you have some questions, and I hope I will be able to answer them. Thank you. Some kind of vision, and we don't have any possibility to fail or to get feedback, but this is not how I think, and this is not how I think it should work. Because failing actually is really, really essential. That's how we learn. So, the whole idea that we shouldn't analyze before the development, but we should know the idea where to go during the development, so we should have some analysis. Have a goal and direction, but analysis shouldn't stop there. Shouldn't be handed over to programmers who will just fill in the gaps with some weird logic, with ifs and thens and for cycles. So analysis should be continuous. And my idea is that if you do the work, if you stop the work before the development, it's actually quite a huge waste. And that's how your work is anonymous. It's like, yeah, you've done something, but I mean, we are not sure that anyone will actually use it. So, but on the other hand, as I said, knowledge development is a knowledge creation process. So we need to study more about the domain. And there are really complicated domains that that we cannot understand. But developers, after all, write the logic. We realize your abstract thoughts and ideas into something concrete as math logic. So they should know anyway as much as analyst does at a given time. And I hope that answers your question. Okay, no more questions.
I have a similar question, and I'll do this one a bit more precisely. Let's say we have a Scrum team, we do product development. So what is the analyst role here? Is he the product owner? What is he? Is he one of the team, one person of the team?
It's a good question. So yeah, he's a part of the team, and traditionally he cannot be a product owner, right? Because product owner, we want to have somebody from the customer side. But if analyst is able to provide us that customer perspective, so he can help the product owner to create knowledge, and he can also help the team with a lot of questions that we have to ask directly from customer, and we can ask directly from that guy who is sitting with us together with us. So, and I think also this also rose a lot of confusion that when we have an old waterfall structure company, so we don't know actually how analyst fits in there, because he neither Scrum Master, neither product owner, he's somewhere nearby. So, and I think, so the analyst is a researcher, so he helps us to give customer perspective, and he is deputy product owner or something like that.
But one more.
Go ahead. We have also one question here.
So then in that case, got one person who knows what to do, because he's analyst, he is analyzing what we have in product backlog, and all developers are waiting from him what's happening, how to do this, and we have one bottleneck, which in case of, for example, if we have our requirements from customer later, we got a bottleneck that can process it in time, and so his role will become a little bit as a problem, because all will waiting for specifications, for some information, what we should share, and there is some problem.
Okay, so basically what you partially explained is that how some people do Scrum, right? So first five sprints we do analysis sprints, right? Next five sprints we do development sprints. Next five sprints we do testing sprints, and then we deploy it. So, and you ask them, how are you using Scrum? Damn it, we have daily stand-ups. So what you described is basically not water Scrum, it's a Scrum bot or Scrum wall, because we will be just waiting for that guy to provide the input. So in Scrum there are such things as spikes. So if you see that there is some story that needs let's say further analysis, that we need more time to spend before we actually start working on it, so we can take it into the sprint and we can assign it beforehand to, for instance, analysts or a team, some developers and analysts, so that we wouldn't share the knowledge between each other. And so of course we would like to resolve all those knowledge gaps before the development will start. Well, at least in some direction. We cannot resolve everything. But so that we would be able to start, see how it works, and then adjust.
But if Agile is flexible too, as it is, so I can have requirements a week before.
Yeah.
So for analysis, I have if some question happening, I am preparing for next sprint. I have information, a lot of information, plus I have some topic to analyze, and it's with high priority. And what's happening? Analyst is full of work. He don't know what to do.
But you said it's high priority, so how come he has? So that's the idea of prioritization. But if it's that important, if you want to have it really done during that sprint, so you drop everything else and you focus on that. So if you allow your team to work on something else, maybe that it's not that important. And maybe what you have to think of is cutting down a bit of scope. Don't try to put everything out in 2 weeks, what is impossible to put out in 2 weeks.
Okay. So I have a question about the Scrum team. So we're using in current organization, we have 8 Scrum teams. I used to have one system analyst and one product owner in the team. But as we see, for developers especially, there should be a one single point of contact in the team. So that is a product owner. How do you see the analyst and product owner collaborate together? Because if a product owner tells one thing to do and the system analyst gives another perspective of the problem, what happens then? Who has the final word?
When you put them together in one meeting room and try to show how they agree. So, because you cannot have two thoughts on the same problem. So you just say that what you're suggesting is totally opposite of what that guy said is suggesting. So of course we should trust product owner because that's a business guy, but maybe he has a point. So please agree, and if it's not minor thing, then we will do it. And after that we will be able to do it. So I think we'll do like that.
So, the question
is... Please wait for the microphone, since all the sound is recorded through the microphone and translated into the internet as well. So
later on, we have
plenty of time, so don't worry. Everyone will have an opportunity to ask.
Thank you. The question is maybe not the question, but the idea of the analysts is now that he is like a translator and he translates the idea of business to the technical guys. And but the idea of your presentation is to show that he must not translate the book, but translate just the parts of idea, but in some Scrum commands, they delegate this part to the system owner, to the owners, and they throw away the analysts. So maybe this is the idea.
Well, basically, maybe the best way to answer that is that what you want to avoid is delegation here. So, even if you have a Scrum team and you have analysts there, so we don't want developers to delegate something to analysts. So we want to have as less specialization as possible. We want everybody to be cross-functional. And that's why I think also analysts should be participating in backlog and in test creation. That's how they get also hands dirty and they hands applied. So I'm not sure if that answers your question, by the way. But
A little bit.
Thank you. how to answer it fully?
No, I don't know the full answer. I don't know the full answer, but in the idea of the analyst that he doesn't involved in the testing, in the development. He's like you said, with the clear hands. He sits on the clouds and saw what's going on down there.
And can't fail.
Saying that kind of we don't need to do this analysis like in the beginning of the project and kind of keep the analyst all the time and he's like working full time, or basically like you do analysis like in the beginning and then the analyst kind of supports the team during like programming.
So before the development, we should definitely know where to start. We should understand enough to get started. So that is a bit of analysis also. So and after that, that would depend on the complication of the domain. So ideally, the developers and cross-functional team would take care of that, but their situation is not possible also. So ideally, because involving developers is essential because we should understand as much as analysts do. So they anyway have to do the same work. So even if it's on a paper and etc., that doesn't matter because we should clearly understand what logic they will create based on those ideas. So, but of course there are complicated domains, for instance, yeah, taxes, banking, and many others. You cannot get that knowledge into developers at that speed, like in 2 weeks. So you need somebody who would be able, who would be there full time, hopefully, and explain it to you, so that you would understand and code it. So also a kind of message to developers that you cannot just code. You should understand what you're doing, because you create logic.
Why do you think that analysts cannot fail? I think let them fail and fail quickly. That's the agile way, actually. It's the way we do sprints. You fail, you fail on the sprint, you do the story another way.
Yeah, but if analysis is already done before the development, and it's handed over to developers, so they go right, and developers are guilty of not making their dreams come true. So that's what people see, especially in PM department.
And analysts has successfully moved to another project.
Yeah, and they cannot help you anymore, so you're on your own. And
but again, in waterfall model, you can use change management because for example, specification is artifact what we create in development, and so you can change and continue to use your specification and continue to let it remain up to date. So what's there is, I don't know what's different there, because I can in either approach, in all approach, you should only have a man who can answer the question. A general one, okay, it's remain in sprints. You can fail, you can correct your mistake, and so on. In waterfall, for example, you can do specification and then correct it, but it's more difficult, but you can do it. More costly, yes, but you can do it.
That's also what I said, that every process comes with its own price. So we know the price of waterfall, but you're basically slow. You're slow on adjusting, and also there are quality issues, right? So, you can, in Agile, you can move faster, but you have the problems of collaboration, right? So you need developers who are able to speak. We cannot sit in a corner and produce some super code. So I'm not saying that it's not possible. I'm saying that in Agile, you can do faster. So because probably in Agile team, you don't have to have a specification because you sit all together and you know as much as anybody else in the team knows. So that's how you go faster. And if somebody in the team has a dedicated time to help you understand and learn more, I think it's even awesome.
But it's a cost. It's one more person in the team.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know what persons, percentage in my team he will participate. I don't know if I can give him a go and so on and so on.
Yeah, but you will also go faster. So that idea of full utilization, it's like, a great example about full utilization is a computer, right? So if you force your computer to work 100% low CPU, it actually doesn't work. So we shouldn't focus on that. And if you compare it with waterfall and agile, so we know that with iterative development we will go faster, so that will probably cover your cost if you think about that aspect.
Okay.
So I will be also around here, so don't kill me that much, don't hit me. So, but come argue with me, please. Please do that. So I would really love that. So I'm not saying that I'm the only instance of truth, by the way. So please argue.